Thank you, my brother deputy, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Leader of the Opposition, distinguished officers of the party. You hear me now? Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, 22 years ago, when you first elected me at the age of 42 as your party leader, I could best have been described as an improbable choice, having previously been chairman of, member of parliament for, and cabinet minister in the PLP government. Having first been elected leader of our party on the 17th of May, 1990, the same month, I've come this morning to say thank you for making and keeping me as the longest serving leader of the FNL. Nearly half of the existence of our party, 19 years. I retired after 12 years as your leader, and you summoned me back 3 years later. I express my gratitude to you for permitting me to lead you into four general elections. In three of them, we became the government. Indeed, we won three of the last five general elections in the Bahamas, with huge majorities in our first two terms, 57% of the vote in 1997. I accept responsibility for our most recent loss at the poll. This party and the Bahamian people made me what I could never, as a boy, have dreamed of becoming. You and the people of the Bahamas caused me to go places and to meet people I would never had the opportunity to visit and to meet. And you both, you and the public, gave me the opportunity to interact with the movers and the shakers of the world in government, in finance, in world affairs, in banking and business, in travel and tourism, in law enforcement, in music and the arts, in health, in education, environmental conservation. I was afforded the opportunity by you to influence and to help to shape policies that will govern and guide not only our country, but our region for years to come. I am now the last of the leaders in the Western Hemisphere, from Canada in the north to Argentina in the south, who were elected during the 90s to leave office. Many who came after me in this hemisphere have also moved on. Upon my return to leadership of the party 7 years ago, I promised two things. I promised to stay as long as I could, or as long as the Bahamian people would have me. Well, the Bahamian people in their majority have now determined that it is time for me to go. I accept their decision, and I thank them for the confidence they previously reposed in me for 15 years as Prime Minister of the Bahamas. Indeed, I thank the people of the Bahamas for having me for a longer period of time than I desired or expected. I'm happy, though, that this day, the people of the Bahamas who made the decision for me to go. I confess, I am happy to go. It is therefore now time for me to relinquish the leadership of our party. Some were here in the party when I came, left after I came. Many others came in with me, and many, many more came after me. To those who stayed after I came, to those who came with me, and to those who came after me, I ask that you stay and continue the important work of our party. To those who left after I came, I ask you to return now that I'm gone. I note that we were financially challenged during this general election. When those who opposed us commenced their election television campaigns early, we did not. Not because we didn't want to, but because we couldn't afford a television campaign at the time. We needed more money to run a more effective campaign this year. We finished the campaign carrying about $1 million in debt, which our new leadership team will need to address and settle moving forward. You will know that our party does not accept all offers of financial support for its election campaigns. It has always been critically important to the Free National Movement that its funding come from reputable sources and further financial support not compromise the hand of the government should assume office as government. I express therefore sincere thanks and appreciation to all those who contributed to the funding of our campaign. I was especially encouraged by the wide cross-section of Bahamians who supported our party by means of online donations at our party's campaign website. During the 3 weeks plus of the online fundraising campaign, we raised some $131,000 through contributions ranging from $5, $10, $20, $50 to hundreds of dollars. In all, some 363 persons donated online, 30 others made direct deposits to our bank account, and still others took small cash donations to our headquarters on Mackey Street. I believe this initiative to involve a wide cross-section of Bahamians in supporting our party bodes well for the development of our democracy. It is my hope that such fundraising will continue, demonstrating real ownership of our party by you, the people. I hope that such fundraising initiatives will soon enough assist the party in maintaining a fuller presence in the media throughout the life of this parliament, ensuring that our message remains relevant and our message is received and understood by the wider Bahamian public. I thank from the bottom of my heart all the volunteers who gave freely of their time and talents to advance our message throughout the 2012 general election campaign. I've always found your loyalty and support to be inspirational. As I leave your leadership, I look back to when we began down the road of deliverance. Back then, we didn't even have a headquarters building, as we met in a borrowed space in the back of a building off Shirley Street, poorly lit. After four successive general election defeats, F&Ms by 1990, having never danced in the streets in victory, were anxious to win. And when we did, defeating the ruling party first in Marco City, and then ending their six consecutive terms in office. I vividly recall our first victory in Marco City. Once victory was declared, Sir Kendall Isaacs, our former leader, came dancing into our hotel suite in Freeport. He said he'd never had the pleasure before dancing in victory. You're simply the best. And I recall returning to Nassau the next day with my then deputy, Orville Turncrest. When his feet hit the tarmac here at Nassau Airport, he also began to dance. He told me that he too had never had the pleasure of returning to Nassau after the election victory over the sitting government. I also remember Noel Roberts. He was tearful during a 1992 campaign rally in the Bogue Naughty Lutra. He said to me then that he'd never before been able to hold a public meeting in the settlement of the Bogue because of the overwhelming control of that settlement by the PLP. In fact, in 1987, the F&M got 32 votes in the Bogue and the PLP got 262. But gradually, we won the support of more and more residents in the Bogue as they recognized it was the F&M that had their backs. Still as late as 2007, we only got 99 votes in the Bogue, polling division. This time, we got 194 votes in the Bogue. You're simply the best. We were just 13 votes fewer than our opponent. And this time, we won Upper Bogue for the first time ever. Indeed, it was the support from Upper and Lower Bogue and the Bluff which cost us to keep the Naughty Lutra seat in the FNM hands this time. And so goes the story of the FNM. We've made our party acceptable to people who were poor now believe that support for the FNM was equal to heresy. We all remember the victory of 1992, when finally the veil was lifted, the power removed. Bahamians of every race and class, from every walk of life, of every political affiliation, and every one of our islands believed that they could enjoy the full, unfettered benefits of citizenship. In winning, we, the FNM, changed the Bahamas forever and ever. We provided competent, honest, and productive governance. What we accomplished is the demonstrable modernization of our country. 1992 ushered in a new era in which the Bahamas moved beyond the promise of nationhood to its fulfillment. We turned away from a culture of privilege and introduced the era of government in the sunshine, government committed to accountability and transparency in all its dealings. We freed the airwaves, making it possible for Bahamians to enjoy the fullest expression of freedom of speech and democracy, deepened by open, free, private broadcasting for the first time ever. We facilitated the introduction of cable television and access to the internet, bringing the information age to our country. Today, our ICT sector, including radio, television, telecommunications, and internet, is fully privatized and regulated by an independent body, IRCA. We computerized the public sector. In each term in office, we reached new milestones in the reduction of bureaucracy and improvement in the delivery of services to the general public, including applications for business licenses and drivers and vehicle licenses, machine-readable passports, the rationalization and reduction of the number of customs duty rates. We reduced the size of the House of Assembly, eliminated 11 seats, the minimum allowed under the Constitution, and we conducted hassle-free, problem-free general elections on each occasion we were able in office to organize them. We privatized areas of the economy, better operated by the private sector, most notably in hotel ownership and operations and telecommunications. We, the FNM, reinvented our tourism sector, introduced in same resorts, beginning the development of Atlantis on Paradise Island. And during our most recent term in office, we made the redevelopment of Barmar Resort and Cable Beach possible, and won agreement for the award of $400 million in contracts to Bahamian contractors on that project. In our family islands, we promoted and facilitated the development of small, environmentally friendly boutique hotels, bonefish and lodges, and guest houses. We accelerated diversification of the economy, making the dream of container transshipment a reality in Freeport, Grand Bahama, and further facilitating the development of the ship and high-end yacht care and repair industry in Freeport. We deepened Bahamian ownership in the economy, facilitating the acquisition a fee simple title to crown and government-owned land for thousands of Bahamians. Thousands more became homeowners for the first time, facilitated by the economic expansion which our policies created during the 90s. We created the Bahamas Securities Exchange, BISIC. Today, thousands of Bahamians are owners of shares in profitable businesses, previously the sanctum of the government, and a small select group, notably the Bank of the Bahamas, Cable Bahamas, and a new port at Iwaki. We measurably expanded and upgraded our national school plant from preschool to tertiary level education, undertaking an extensive program to construct new primary and secondary schools around the country, introducing preschool places for four-year-old children. We enhanced the work environment and terms of employment of teachers and created a teaching career path. We devolved the College of the Bahamas into an autonomous institution and made it tuition-free for qualified Bahamian students. We grew the number of tertiary level scholarships available to Bahamians and instituted a $100 million education loan program under which the government assumed responsibility for 50% of the interest payments. We improved and increased social assistance to those most in need. We expanded the network of modern health clinics around the country, instituted free prenatal care for pregnant women in all public hospitals and clinics, and improved the delivery of public health services. And we introduced free antiviral treatment for HIV-positive pregnant women, and subsequently extended it to all HIV-infected individuals. We reduced the work week in the Bahamas from 48 hours to 40 hours, introduced minimum wage in the public and private sector, improved conditions and safety standards in the workplace, increased maternity benefits, and introduced familial leave and labor law for the first time. We created the Industrial Tribunal to facilitate the settlement of trade issues. We introduced elected local government of Family Islands, thus deepening and expanding our democracy and fulfilling the long-deferred dream of many who struggle for majority rule. We brought never-before-experienced transparency to our immigration processes, regularizing the immigration status of the foreign-born children and spouses of Bahamian citizens, and removing the fear and uncertainty that distressed and tore apart so many families for so many years in this country. We regularized the status of thousands of other long-term residents of Bahamas, teachers, doctors, nurses, prison officers, other public servants, and significant investors in our economy, who had contributed and continue to contribute in meaningful ways to our development as a people and as a nation through careers that spanned as many as 40 years. So as to ensure the protection of our biodiversity and protect our natural environment, we more than doubled the size of the national park system, created and then expanded a network of marine protected areas, legislated protection of marine mammals, sharks, and marine turtles, modernized legislation and regulation of the built environment, making environmental impact assessments mandatory under defined circumstances, and increased the government's subvention to the Bahamas National Trust tenfold. During our last terms in office, notwithstanding the terrible world economic condition, indeed, the worst financial crisis in 80 years, we undertook some of the big things that were required to be done to make our capital island not only more livable, but also more functional. This island of New Providence has therefore been transformed into a modern city with the potential to be the most efficient small city in our region. Nassau Harbor was dredged and now accommodates the largest ocean-going cruise ships. Phase one construction of the new U.S. Departure Terminal, the LPIA, is completed and operational. Phase two redevelopment of the International Departures Terminal is on schedule for completion later this year, and we fully expect that the third phase and final phase of the development of the domestic terminal will be completed and opened next year, and arrangements are being left in place for it to be done. After years of daydreaming about the removal of cargo shipping from the center of our city center, freight cargo shipping has now been removed from downtown Nassau. A new port of Nassau has been created at Iowa Key, and a new 100,000 square foot customs warehouse constructed at Gladstone Road. Downtown Bay Street has been revitalized, following the replacement of leaky water mains and the upgrade of other underground utility services in the city of Nassau, and workers continue on the refurbishment upgrades of the House of Parliament and judicial complexes. The reconstruction of the Pompeii Museum and the creation of Pompeii Square at the western entrance to downtown Nassau, by the replacement of sidewalks in the downtown area and the pedestrianization of Charlotte Street, where asphalt is going to be replaced with stone pavers. The New Providence Infrastructure Upgrade Program, bringing this island's road network and water and sewage services up to 21st century standards, is nearing completion. As part of that project, proper sidewalks, drainage, and street lighting are being installed in what were some of the most blighted over-the-hill communities. And the elegant four-lane airport gateway project is well underway. An important component of that project is bringing improved water quality and supply to communities in eastern New Providence. The transformation of Princess Margaret Hospital, including the construction of a new critical care wing, is underway. The new Harry Moore Library at the College of Bahamas is now open and will assist that institution in its progress to university status. Significant infrastructure upgrades are undertaken in our Family Islands, including public service accommodations and facilities, and the construction of two new community hospitals in Abaco and Exuma now underway. And unemployment benefit is now in place, as is the National Prescription Drug Plan. And the original terms of the government's $100 million education loan have been restored. Our successors in office will now reap the fruits of our labor. The economy has begun to grow, and the tide, instead of ebbing, has begun to rise. It is the luck of the draw that the planters will not be the reapers. I'm especially pleased and deeply proud that during 3 months of the terms in office, we successfully implemented our policy initiatives, first formally outlined and pronounced in my address to you in 1990 at our convention on the 30th of November. We must never forget from whence we came and what we did to fulfill our promise of deliverance for the Bahamian people. This notwithstanding, we've also had two major disappointments, certainly I have. The failure to achieve full equality for women and men under our national constitution, and the still unresolved dilemma of the status and position of children born in the Bahamas to illegal immigrants. F&Ms, remember always you are now in opposition. As a party, your focus must be on returning to the government. You must therefore hold the governing party accountable for all the outlandish promises it made during the election campaign. And you must do so at every opportunity. And you may start with crime and continue with the economy and education. I wish to thank all those whose labor and support help make our achievements in government possible. To my brother deputy, Brent Simonet, my deputies, my first two terms in office, Sorrel Turnquest, Norma Frank Watson, I offer profound thanks and appreciation for your unstinting service to our people. I also recognize and thank with much appreciation all who served in my cabinet beginning in 1992. Each of you was an important part of the team that delivered. I acknowledge and thank all our party officers, and I'm especially grateful to our members and supporters throughout the Bahamas, and indeed to all Bahamians. I acknowledge with gratitude the tremendous love and affection and goodwill which you, the membership and supporters of our party, have bestowed on me over the years. Know that it is returned in full measure. I thank you all, as do my wife Dolores and all my children. May God bless you and continue to watch over you and our great movement and our nation. I am proud of our service to the Bahamas. I did my best. I remain confident that the work I did will speak for me long after I departed life. You are my people. I am forever in your debt. Thank you, and I leave as I came.